Welcome to HealthWatch, presented by Novant Health. I'm your host, June Baker. Our show features local physicians and health professionals discussing health topics of importance to local residents. Today, we will meet Dr. John Moore of Novant Health Oceanside Family Medicine in Southport. We will also chat with Dr. William King of Wilmington GI, and he'll answer some common questions on acid reflux and heartburn. Stay tuned to learn about valuable health topics with HealthWatch. Our first guest for the day is Dr. Moore of Novant Health Oceanside Family Medicine in Southport. Welcome to the show, Dr. Moore.
Thank you.
It's such a pleasure to have you here. And I would like to start off by asking you how long you've been in the area.
Been here about 6 months now.
So you're a newbie.
Yes, I am.
Well, I'm curious, what brought you to Brunswick County?
Well, we've always liked the ocean and the coast, basically. Grew up in New England, lived in Maine, and have always tried to make our way back. Opportunity arose, and we took advantage, and here we are.
Well, let's talk a little bit about your education and your background. Where did you go to school?
Well, okay. I've got a kind of a varied background. I used to be a pharmacist.
Really?
Yeah. I went to school in Boston, went to Massachusetts College of Pharmacy. Practiced for 3 years up in rural Maine, the most northern part of Maine you can get to. It's right on the border of Canada. Ran a hospital pharmacy and basically decided while I was there that I'd attend medical school. Went to school at Des Moines University in Iowa, and then did my intern residency in Columbus, Ohio, doctors, and at Ohio State University.
Right.
And that's, basically my background.
That's very interesting that you started out as a pharmacist. Recently, I've met quite a few physicians who've started out in another area, even nursing, and then went on to medical school.
It's fairly common. I had probably five pharmacists in my medical school class, a couple PAs and the like, if you will. So I think it's a natural transition. It's certainly... gives you experience in other venues, if you will, of medicine, and then, you work your way into being a doctor.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, now I understand that you are now at a practice in Southport. It's called Oceanside Family Medicine Southport.
Right. Southport. Mm-hmm.
And that was formerly Comprehensive Medical. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah. We had a name change. The prior physician that had run the practice had a purely internal medicine practice. I'm a family practitioner. I've done a lot of internal medicine, but I have some other interests as well. And we've kind of changed the name.
Now, where is it located?
It's located on 5130 Southport Supply Road. Mm-hmm. It's in a small little...
I believe that's near the intersection of Long Beach Road and 133.
That's
there
right.
In Southport.
That's
is that
right.
Correct?
Yep, not too far from the Lowe's and that... in the Southport area.
Mm-hmm.
Fairly easily accessible.
Mm-hmm.
Not downtown, per se.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is your role there? You are the only physician
I'm the only
at
physician,
this
so, yeah, physician, medical director. My role is basically to run the practice and then look to the future as to, where we're going with the practice, the
right.
things, I want to do versus what's needed in the community.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious, does Oceanside Family Medicine Southport provide the same services that Comprehensive Medical did?
Yeah, pretty much so. We see general medical problems, chronic, acute. I don't have x-ray facilities, although I do have a laboratory, so we can do laboratories. We have the ability to do some procedures, skin growths, abscesses, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
We may in the future be bringing in things like ultrasound and that, but at this point that's not available. But yeah, pretty much I believe what was accessible before is so now.
Now, I know your family practice, and family practice typically sees children. I'm curious, how young of a young person do you do take? At what age do you begin seeing?
We'll probably be looking at least at this point, 18, but that may be changing in the near future from 10 and above. That would be my goal. But at this point, pretty much 18 and above is, you know, the patients that we're seeing.
Mm-hmm. Now, you did say that you offer some types of procedures there, removal of some things. And then if that were beyond your scope, you would then transfer or refer those patients out. Is that
sure.
correct?
Sure, yeah. If, in fact, you had, say, an abscess that was, you know, out of the scope of, you know, an office procedure, I'd set you up with a, you know, a surgeon. And we make that phone call for you and make that procedure set up. Try to do it as fast as we can. Make it as easy and seamless as we can to get you into an office. If in fact we can't, you know, do the procedure, or if I believe it's, you know, in the case of an abscess, too big or too complicated
right.
to do it as an outpatient, we'll get you in as fast as we can.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of our philosophy. I try to get people, you know, someplace else if they need to be as fast and as easily as possible. We do all the referrals ourselves. If I think you need to be seen today, I'll make the phone call today and we'll get you in, we'll get you seen.
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. I, as a patient, would appreciate a service like that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any particular focus or areas that you'd like our viewers to know about?
Well, I like general medicine in particular, but I do, I've had an interest all my life in sports medicine, although I'm not doing a lot of it at this point. I've basically been in charge of a small university sports program in the past. I've done a lot of sports medicine, a lot of on the field football, basketball, and the like. A number of years ago, I actually did the Special Olympics in Raleigh. I was the
that's wonderful.
Weightlifting physician, which was kind of interesting. it was really kind of, that was actually pretty rewarding. So,
I bet that was rewarding. Well, I know that you recently did an interview with the Wilmington Star on family fitness.
Right.
Talk to me a little bit about family fitness and how we can encourage families to work out together and to eat healthy. And
well, the interview, we talked about, generally speaking, a number of different ways to stay healthy, and it's pretty simple in a lot of respects. Simple but not easy, if you will. Simple ideas, I guess. We talked about exercise and some kind of aerobic exercise along with some kind of weight-type exercise. Actually, fairly simple, and you don't need machines, and you don't need a lot of equipment. You don't need to join a gym. You can walk. Walking is incredibly easy, and it gets a lot of good results. So walking, and certainly no one has to run. If you're a runner, you like to run. You don't really have to run to stay in shape. You can have a decent pace, and you can run. So families can do that. You can young children, husband, wife. If you have some elders in your family, they can oftentimes do the same as well. We talked about healthy heart-like dieting, which would be low cholesterol, more legumes, more nuts, more fruits, and probably quantities of foods are important, kind of pushing away a little bit versus, eating as much as possible.
Stay away from the buffets.
Yes.
Right?
Well, yeah, buffets are, notoriously dangerous.
Or supersizing.
Yeah, supersizing, yeah, for sure, yeah. But, and that's part of it, too, trying to stay away from fast foods and that sort of thing, eating at home, eating, relatively good food, if you will.
Well, let me ask you this.
Okay.
Is it okay to walk in spurts? For instance, if I didn't have like an hour to do it, could I walk 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the afternoon?
Yeah, absolutely.
Are the benefits the same?
Yeah. And and it's oftentimes easier that way. If you're adding on, it is the same. It's somewhat simple math, if you will. You know, I mean, if you did something 10 minutes a day throughout the day, you know, some people have, like if they're sitting at a desk, they have one of these little, almost like a little bicycle.
Oh, yeah, I've seen
those. And you can do that. Or, you know, the other thing a lot of people do that are in an office is standing up at a desk. You're going to have a desk that's standing. If you're just standing, you're actually using calories that you didn't use before when you were sitting.
Really?
So, yeah. So, I mean, you know, if you... you know, have a position where you can do that. Yeah, it's, I mean, it's a great idea. They actually have little steppers too, as well. If in fact, but that might be more difficult. But yeah, you can do that. So you can add it up. Yeah, you can go in the morning, go in the afternoon, and actually a lot of actually, if you look at a lot of like running programs and things mm-hmm. like that for marathons or half marathons, they'll have people. You know, you run in the morning, run in the afternoon, split it up. It's a great way to do it. Not everybody has an hour. It's tough sometimes.
Right, it is tough.
You know, and, you know, if you have a half hour, you know, you wake up a half hour earlier.
Right.
Give or take, do your walking, and mm-hmm. then you're ready to go. Mm-hmm. Do it when you come home.
And then eat moderately. Mm-hmm. And eating better, maybe just watching what you're eating. And
I think watching what you're eating, you know, I mean, staying away from, you know, if you will, the gravies and the heavy foods and that sort of thing.
All the
you
good
know,
stuff,
yeah,
the butter.
Yeah, a lot of things that you like or a lot of things we are all grown up on, really, probably aren't really what we need, you know, mm-hmm. certainly. Yeah. So, like I said, I mean,
well, that's great
simple.
Information.
Yeah, relatively simple.
That's great information. I think too often we don't... have the ability to consult with a nutritionist or something, and so mm-hmm. we're left to our own mm-hmm. devices.
Trying to figure it out what's going on.
Right.
We also talked about meditation. It's kind of a...
Oh, I'm glad you brought that up.
An interesting subject. Probably 10 years ago, I was at a conference in Boston and picked up a book about... it's called The Relaxation Response. I'm not plugging a book, but... there's a cardiologist in Boston back in the early 70s, actually, uh-huh. who wrote a book called Relaxation Response. And he had developed this theory that there's something called the fight or flight reflex, which has to do with you see a dog coming at you, you get all geared up, your heart starts racing, your blood pressure goes, you're ready to either fight that right. dog or run. So he thought you could do the opposite. You know, could you look at you know, something such that you could... an example, bring your blood pressure down by thinking about it or by relaxing. And it's basically a lot of meditation. Mm-hmm. And then bottom line is he proved it. He went to India and he studied in the Himalayas. He studied Hindus and he did blood studies. And he proved his point that, yes, you can do some good for your blood pressure, pulse, etc., just by meditation. And not just a one-time deal, though. It's almost like taking a pill. You got to take it on a daily basis, mm-hmm. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, but it adds up. So I was a skeptic, and I'm not anymore. And I believe it works. You know, he was somewhat chastised back in the 70s by the medical community, and now at Mass General, at Beth Israel in Boston, they have departments that are basically geared at this.
Really?
So, yeah, so it's proven to be a worthwhile thing. And I usually talk to people with high blood pressure, and we talk about white coat hypertension.
Right.
And one of the ways you can kind of beat that is through meditation and breathing mm-hmm. exercises. And again, it doesn't cost you anything. It's pretty simple. It takes about 10 minutes a day. So.
I'm so glad you brought that up. I would like more information on that. I'm mm-hmm. going to have to do some research on that.
It's easy to find his book. Again, not plugging it, but it's on eBay, probably about $10 or $12.
Great.
And they have used ones as well.
Great. So. Well, it's been wonderful having you here today.
Thank you.
Learned so much. I know our viewers have. And if we have a viewer out there that would like to schedule an appointment, mm-hmm. Can you tell us how we might do that?
Yeah, you can just give us a call, 910-454-4032, and we'll set you up for an appointment as soon as we can.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for being here.
Sure. Well, thank you for asking.
Yep. You're welcome. Our next guest is gastroenterologist Dr. William King of Wilmington GI. Well, welcome to the show, Dr. King. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to begin today about learning a little bit about you and your background and your education, and I know our viewers out there are interested in hearing that too. So Where did you go to school?
Okay. Well, I'm a native of New Bern, North Carolina, first of all.
Oh, you are a North Carolinian.
Yes,
how
ma'am.
About that?
So born and raised there. I went to Davidson College for undergrad.
Yeah.
And then UNC Chapel Hill for medical school.
Oh, awesome school.
I'm a Tar Heel. Then I did my post-medical school training in Boston. I spent 3 years in internal medicine internship and residency.
Uh-huh.
And then followed by gastroenterology fellowship for 2 years.
Wow.
And then I was on faculty at the Boston VA and Boston City Hospital for a year.
Wow.
Before I finally made it back to North Carolina.
That's an impressive resume there. Well, now I understand that you're with Wilmington GI.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
So tell me a little bit about your group and where you're located.
So we're in Wilmington,
mm-hmm.
and we've been in existence since 2000, so 13 years.
Yeah.
Okay. There are seven physicians,
mm-hmm.
Doctors Meyer, Kittinger, Heenahan, Klein, Carney, Sauer, and me. And we have about seven physician assistants who assist us
wow.
with seeing patients as well. So it's a busy office.
Very busy office. I have to, that's so funny. You know, you ask people about their children and what are their names or their grandchildren, and I'm like, Brett, Shane. I'm going, you know, and you just whipped out those.
I've done that many times.
I bet you have. Now, we recently had Dr. Sauer on the show.
Right, I know that, yes.
Yeah, and so that was a great interview, and so we're really happy to have you here today
Thanks.
To learn
Thanks.
About you. Now, one of the things that Dr. Sauer shared with us on the show, that she's now offering colonoscopies and endoscopies at Novant Health Brunswick Medical Center. Are you also offering those procedures there?
Right. Dr. Sauer and I sort of started that program together.
Mm-hmm.
We've been talking about it with Novant or Brunswick for years, and it finally came to fruition.
Finally.
It's been a work in progress, but we're very excited to be here, and we're both coming once a month, so it means one of us is here every 2 weeks right now.
Awesome.
And we, of course, hope to increase that as the volume increases, and
mm-hmm.
hopefully this is the start of a big relationship with Novant, and we hope to have an office here where we can see patients eventually.
That would be,
that's our ultimate goal.
That'd be great if yeah. you had a satellite office in this area.
We think there's a need for more gastroenterology service to patients here, and we hope to be a part of that.
Mm-hmm. Now, speaking of gastroenterology, some of our viewers may not know what a gastroenterologist is. So could you explain that briefly for our viewers?
It's a big word, yes.
It is a very big word.
No, gastroenterology, I tell people it's from the mouth to the other end. So there's a lot of organs involved. but the esophagus, stomach, small intestine, large intestine, liver disease is also part of our specialty.
I didn't realize that for a long time.
As well as the pancreas and what we call the bile ducts and gallbladder or biliary tree. So,
mm-hmm.
so there's a lot of diseases, processes, a lot of organs, which is what keeps my job interesting.
Do you have any specialties or interests that you have in particular? Are you more interested in one area than the other? Or?
I think my particular interests are a couple things. One is what we call inflammatory bowel disease. You may have heard of Crohn's disease
I
or
have.
Ulcerative colitis.
Mm-hmm.
So inflammatory conditions, mainly of your large intestine, sometimes your small intestine. So
mm-hmm.
I have a lot of patients with those diseases. I've always had an interest in liver disease
really?
Way back from when I was in Boston, and we have a huge liver practice in our office, mainly hepatitis C or cirrhosis patients, but
mm-hmm.
any type of liver disease. And then, of course, our office, including me, see a lot of patients just for colonoscopy, for colon cancer screening, and then the myriad of stomach disorders, ulcers, acid reflux,
mm-hmm.
and so forth.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the common symptoms and disorders that you might see at Wilmington GI? I know you briefly.
Yeah, I think I just touched on that. I think
mm-hmm.
a lot of our patients also have what might be called irritable bowel syndrome,
mm-hmm.
if you've heard of that, or
right.
sort of irritable stomach syndrome and that sort of thing. So it's that plus the things I just mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
I think are big
for many reasons. Then
right. Right.
Mm-hmm. Do you need a referral to see your practice?
No, not at all.
Mm-hmm.
You can call yourself, whether it's for an office appointment or a
mm-hmm.
colonoscopy or whatever. Just call our office. You do not need a referral.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a physician, we will do our best to obtain your records, so we know some things about you when you come, but just call the office.
So if it were time for my colonoscopy, say, I could just call the office and refer myself.
Absolutely. If you had a colonoscopy, you know, previously, maybe up north or wherever, we will do our best to obtain that prior to maybe me performing a colonoscopy, but just call the office and we will make it happen. Yes, ma'am.
Great, great. Not that I'm excited.
That's right. No one is, but you need to.
Well, one of the common things we hear a lot about is heartburn or reflux. Is heartburn and reflux, are they one and the same?
Yes. so we all have acid reflux to some degree, but basically every one of us.
If
you eat too much or too late or whatever.
Or the wrong thing.
You're going to have some reflux. So everybody has acid reflux to some degree. And we see people who have, you know, the more severe types of reflux.
And what would the symptoms of heartburn be? What would be the most common symptom of a heartburn?
So the most common symptom is of acid reflux is heartburn, which is
that
is
burning the sensation.
Burning sensation
in your throat.
Around your heart or underneath your breastbone, right? So a lot of patients have other related symptoms. They may have nausea. They may have just more frank chest pain that makes them think they're having a heart attack and going to the emergency room for acid reflux. You can have more stomach pain or more indigestion rather than true heartburn. And some people don't have any symptoms at all, which is a little scary, but we only see them when they have complications of reflux, yet they've not really had significant heartburn or whatever through the years.
What would be some of the common methods or a good method of treating heartburn or acid reflux? What are some of the treatments for that?
So I think you have to look at what causes reflux, and let me talk about those for a second. But I think being overweight is a huge cause, and acid reflux is increasing in America because the average American is becoming more and more overweight compared to 30 or 40 years ago. So obesity is a big risk factor, cigarette smoking, alcohol, taking too many anti-inflammatory pills or aspirin products. Some medications, particularly prescription medicines, may increase the likelihood or exacerbate reflux, would be another issue. You hear a lot about a hiatal hernia, which is where the stomach protrudes into the chest cavity, which increases the likelihood or increases the severity of reflux. Hiatal hernias are often related to obesity, so that it's almost one and the same there. But then there's some patients who don't have any of those risk factors who have acid reflux, and that's because the real issue is we all have a sphincter muscle, if you will, here that acts like a one-way valve, opening only when we swallow to let our food or liquid pass transiently and then closes shut. And people with bad reflux, that sphincter or that valve opens when it's not supposed to open, allowing stomach contents, acid, and other injurious enzymes to regurgitate or reflux backwards. So to answer your question of the treatment, it's if you're overweight, it's losing weight. If you're smoking, quitting smoking. If you drink too much, cut down on drinking. Minimize use of anti-inflammatory pills or aspirin products. And then initially, just for mild symptoms, it's all the over-the-counter medicines, of which there are numerous ones now. The best short-acting ones are just the liquid Maalox, Mylanta-type medications, or you know, Pepcid AC, Zantac, that type thing. Those things, those medicines tend to work very quickly. Then you have things like over-the-counter Prilosec or the generic Omeprazole that, while it is stronger than things I just mentioned, it does take longer to build up in our body to become effective. So if you go out and eat too much one night and come home and want to take something, it's not a Prilosec, it's an antacid or a Pepcid AC actually is more effective initially.
I'm curious, with the over-the-counter, for instance, Omeprazole, can you stay on that for long periods of time? Are there side effects?
Yes, and minimal.
Yes and
the answer to those questions.
Yes and no.
You can stay on it long term. There's a common misconception that you can't. The package labeling for the over-the-counter products is don't use more than 14 days without the advice of a physician. And the reason for that is make sure you're not covering up a more serious underlying problem. And I think that's probably good advice. If you need that long term, come see me or talk to your regular physician to make certain that that's the right treatment for you, that's the right medication. The only long-term risk that I think is legitimate is an increased risk of osteoporosis that is slightly, it's very slight, and obviously that's a concern mainly for women, particularly skinny Caucasian women, mm-hmm. Less so for men or other races. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of other talk on the internet about other long-term risk or potential risk. Most of that is probably not accurate.
Really?
Yes.
Well, that's good to know. That's interesting information. Yeah. Now, you talked about that sphincter muscle. How would you determine if that sphincter muscle wasn't working? Would you do, I know you wouldn't do a colonoscopy, would you do an endoscopy or?
Right, so, well, I think we do upper endoscopies. That's where we look from the mouth down into the stomach and the beginning of the intestine. Mm-hmm. Same idea as a colonoscopy, just a different instrument, a different direction,
but
one is sedated for that, just like the colonoscopy.
You said that so daintily.
But that can be very helpful to assess whether you really have reflux or not, and mm-hmm. the severity of reflux, and answer the question of, you know, what medicine or medicines you need or don't need, mm-hmm. and has there been any harm from the reflux? Mm-hmm. Reflux can do a lot of dangerous things.
I was going to ask that. Persistent reflux,
right.
What might occur from the persistent reflux? What are some of the things that could happen?
Well, obviously, persistent symptoms, which are frustrating, but my standpoint, scar tissue that can narrow the esophagus or your swallowing tube, so you have swallowing difficulties. You can have ulcers that bleed. Mm. And the most serious thing is it increases the risk of cancer.
Really?
We have a condition called Barrett's esophagus, which is a pre-cancer condition in the esophagus that results from reflux that can lead to esophageal cancer. So that's one of the reasons to do an endoscopy, to see if you have one of those complications developing, and mm-hmm. again, to plan your therapy moving forward to prevent those complications.
Mm-hmm. Getting back to screening colonoscopies, how often, when do you recommend to get your first one, and how thereafter, how frequently?
So for the average person, it would be age 50.
Age 50.
Okay. Sooner if you have a family history of colon cancer or colon polyps in a close relative, being a parent, brother, sister, or child. Mm-hmm. And thereafter, if you have no polyps and no family history, it's every 10 years. Mm-hmm. If you've had polyps yourself, then it may be 3 years, maybe 5 years, depending upon the results. And if you have a family history, it's generally every 5 years.
So if you have no family history, but if you have, for instance, irritable bowel or something like that, would you have them more frequently, the colonoscopies, or it would still...
Not specifically for irritable bowel syndrome.
Okay.
You may have a colonoscopy to diagnose that, or at least to exclude other processes mm-hmm. like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis that I mentioned. Mm-hmm. So you may often have one at any age for that evaluation, mm-hmm. but you wouldn't need one periodically for those diseases.
Well, I just hear a lot of people say, I have irritable bowel.
Right.
That seems to be very, very common.
But that's not something that dictates repeated colonoscopies. Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis do, but not irritable bowel syndrome.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, really good information. Not great to hear, but...
Well, I always tell people I've had two colonoscopies myself, so I know what it's like.
I wouldn't wish it upon my the prep is always the worst.
Yeah, absolutely, but...
the colonoscopy is a breeze.
It's better than it used to be. The sedation for the procedure is a whole lot better, so the procedure itself is not the issue.
Yeah. So if our viewers out there would like to make an appointment, how might they do that?
Well, to call our office.
Call your office.
Which is 362-1011.
Okay.
We have a website, wilmingtongi.com. Mm-hmm. But to call our office, and my scheduling secretary can handle everything. We are currently scheduling Brunswick Hospital patients through our office still, although eventually we may have a scheduler more locally, but now it's all through the office.
I was going to ask you that. So if a viewer from Brunswick County is calling your office, they should identify themselves as Brunswick County patients requesting to have their procedure at Brunswick.
Absolutely, yes. Or
great.
Else we will never know. So just please state that and let us know. And,
if they don't ask, you won't know. Right?
We aim to please.
They can't read your mind.
Right, exactly. Exactly.
Well, Dr. King, it's been such a pleasure having you here. I can't tell you how much we appreciate your information.
Well, thanks for inviting me. I've enjoyed it. This has been great. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for tuning in to ATMC TV's Health Watch. I hope this information was beneficial for you and your family. If you have any questions or topics that you would like to see discussed on a future show, please email them to atmctv@atmc.coop. Please visit novanthealth.org for more information on Novant Health Brunswick Medical Center, local doctors, and general health information. Thank you again for joining us today. Be sure to join us next time for HealthWatch on ATMC TV.